All right, guys, settle down. Woo. Settle down. I have our grades from chapter 3 exam. Some of you did fairly well. Some of you did all right. Some of you probably should have opened your book. I'm going to pass these out, and if you have any questions, just let me know.
Hey, Ben, did you study for this exam?
Yeah, actually, we studied a lot. Did about 5 practice quizzes. I'll study my ass off.
Oh, man, I didn't study at all. We'll see how this thing goes. All
right, Justin.
All right.
Ben.
Yes.
Justin, with grades like this, I hope you get the valedictorian this year. You are excelling in the classroom with that A+. Ben, I heard you guys won last night.
Yeah, I had about 50 points.
Nice.
10 assists.
Awesome. Keep up the good work on the court.
Thanks.
Sweet.
In this clip, we see two students who are receiving their exams back and are getting their grades. One is a Caucasian student and the other is an African-American student. They both receive the same grades on these exams, yet the Caucasian student is praised for his academic achievement in the grade, and the African-American student is praised for his scores that he got in his game the night before.
So our discussion is on Chapter 8 and the challenge of escaping racial ideology in sports. And the book discusses how the most effective way to diffuse racial ideology is for people to understand each other's histories and heritage and cultural backgrounds. However, in the United States, there is a tendency to label or tag black males in a way that subverts their success in claiming identities that don't fit the expectations of that race. And for example, we see with black males, they could be involved in athletics as well as honors programs, but yet they will be only recognized by their peers and their faculty for their athletic success. However, for African American females, both involved in athletics and academics, they will be praised for both.
In this clip, you will see an opportunity present itself for a resume building experience. The two students are approached by their teacher. However, you quickly witness the opportunity only truly being presented to the white student. This is most likely because the teacher doesn't believe that the black student would value the opportunity as much.
Hey, Ben, have you started applying to colleges yet?
Yeah, I actually applied to Stanford and Harvard. How about you?
Really? Yeah, I applied to those same ones. That's awesome. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, what's your GPA right now?
Right now, I'm up to a 4.5.
Wow.
What's yours?
I have a 4.3.
That's crazy.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. That's awesome, man. Yeah, Ben, you got really good grades, man. You're definitely going to get an Ivy League, for sure.
Hopefully we can go to the same school.
Yeah.
And roommates.
Oh, man, that would be awesome.
That would be great.
Justin, sorry. I saw that you got an A-plus on the test. I was wondering if you could actually help some of the other kids out in our class. They're struggling something, get too good of grades. I don't know, maybe like study with them, tutor them.
I mean, yeah, I could do that, but why don't you ask Ben? Ben got a better grade than I did. He actually wants to major in bio.
Yeah. That's awesome. Actually, I think Coach Manchel needs you down at the gym.
Oh, right now?
Yeah, I think right now. So, right. Justin, do you want to talk about that tutoring a little bit more?
Or? Yeah, okay. Sure.
So continuing the discussion about the challenge of escaping the racial ideology in sports, there are three social and cultural conditions that are added together. The first is a long history of racial ideology that has emphasized black male physicality and innate race-based physical abilities among blacks. The second is a long history of racial segregation and discrimination, which has limited the opportunities for black men to achieve success and respect in society. And the third is the existence of widespread opportunities and encouragement to develop physical skills and excel in a few sports. Those three cultural conditions then feed into the two intermediate consequences. The first being that many blacks, especially young men, come to believe that it is their biological and cultural destiny to become great athletes. And the second being that young black men are motivated to use every opportunity to develop the skills they need to work hard and fulfill their destiny as athletes. So then those two intermediate consequences then result in the hypothesis of the sense of a biological and cultural destiny combined with motivation and opportunities to develop certain sports skills leads some Black men, especially those with a certain physical physique or characteristics, to be outstanding athletes in certain sports and not paying any consideration or taking their academics seriously.
Coakley states in his Sport and Society book that to gain acceptance, Black people must carefully monitor and strategize about how they are seen, understood by people who are not accustomed to their physical presence or intellect, whether on the court, field, or peddling a product. If they are not careful, there's a danger that people will interpret their confidence and intelligence as arrogance and cockiness, or as an indication that they are, quote-unquote, too Black. As stated in Jake's presentation the other day, it is now a code and rule for all NBA players to have a specific dress code. Looking at these photos, we can see a before and after of this dress code being implemented. The first image shows LeBron James in a pregame outfit that he would have worn before the dress code, with acid-washed pants, a chain, and headphones. The second would be an outfit that he would wear present, which is on the GQ magazine of him in a suit. As you can see, which one would the book consider be considered arrogant or cocky, or as an indication that he is too Black?
Performance index. They judge schools on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the best. Do you have any idea where Richmond falls on that scale?
No, ma'am, I have no idea.
We're a 1, Mr. Carter, and have been for the last 7 years. The state rewards schools for their performance, so every year I have less money to pay faculty and staff.
Look, ma'am,
Can I ask what it is you want, Mr. Carter?
I want my boys to go to college.
College? Mr. Carter, Richmond graduates 50% of its students, the higher percentage being girls. Now, in my very educated opinion, you have 15 players on your team. You'll be lucky to graduate 5 of them.
Well, I'm sorry, ma'am, but I don't agree with you. Now, look, these boys signed contracts. Maybe if you read one of them...
Your job is to win basketball games, Mr. Carter. I suggest you start doing your job.
And your job is to educate these kids. I suggest you start doing yours.
This ideology has the possibility of creating life-altering outcomes for young Black men. The lack of praise or attention directed towards their academic success and careers can potentially lead these young men to focus solely on athletics. As fun as that sounds, it sets them up for failure in the long run. By only recognizing the students as athletes, it can also prevent them from finding their career path that they would choose to focus on after their days of athletics. As seen in a previous clip from Coach Carter, this is an example of how we need to combat this ideology and help African American males achieve more than on the court.